Season 3 seemed like the most fun to me because this is the one where they went to the Coachella.
Turn it. Well, you ain't got to worry about me. I could still drop it low. You just gotta help me up though.
Yeah, I'm gonna
fuck
her.
No.
Janelle Monae made it okay.
Hey, girl.
Oh my God! I pissed myself. Don't look at me. Remember me different.
The whole vacation, like everything was to me, it was just hilarious. Like, I
you
laughed
know why
more.
It was the most fun?
Why?
No Lawrence.
Oh my God. No Lawrence showed up at Coachella.
At the end,
he showed up at Coachella.
At the end.
But it's something, as soon as he shows up on the screen, I think of Sweetness because I think of Issa and him.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, Lawrence back. Oh, Lawrence.
And that was the big surprise.
It was remember, at the gas station.
No, because even on social media, people were like, oh, this Lawrence ain't in it. You know, people was thinking he wasn't going to be in it. He didn't post anything about being in the season. I remember there was some little ambiguity about, is he in this season? Is he not in this season? Like, Issa and what's his real name?
Jay Ellis. Yeah.
Even on his social media, he wasn't saying nothing. Like, he was just, they were all quiet. And then when the surprise, and it was like, oh my God, like, you really are on the show, back on the show. And he was like, yeah, like, what did y'all think? So
that I thought you would be gone because I wanted you to be gone.
I like him a lot.
He does feel like home. I'm joking. Lawrence, his failures were not, like, it wasn't that bad. Like, he didn't cheat on you. You know, like, there was no really big betrayal. You know what I'm saying? Like, he didn't steal from you. Like, there wasn't anything that made Lawrence read as toxic.
Right.
So it was just, he was going through some personal depression.
Concern.
And so he, you know, as opposed to, I mean, you would think that in the perfect world, Issa would have helped him through that. But I think Issa was a little bit more concerned with how she is, like, becoming a victim to his depression too, as opposed to, like, let me help dude out.
Right. No, that's fair.
I think they were both at a low point in their life.
True.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at the top of season 3, Issa is at a low point still, because it opens with some, you know, some slapstick lovemaking that's happening. And you think it's Issa and Daniel, but it ain't.
When season 2 ended,
I'm sleeping on the couch.
I know.
When Issa shows up at Daniel's door, everybody was speculating, like, oh, this is not gonna go well. We know what's gonna happen. Issa and Daniel are gonna get back together, or at least get back in the bed together. Mm-hmm. And then I think, I'm sure Issa heard that or saw all those comments.
Yeah.
And so when this scene happened, we all thought it was her and Daniel.
Yes.
Because that's what because we was like, oh, we've seen this before. We know how this script goes. But then she flipped it on us and was like, oh, it's not Issa and Daniel. It's Daniel and someone else.
Someone else.
And then another someone else. And then another someone else. It was like, well, several women.
Is it?
Yup.
Because, but how do we know? Because
they look different.
But did we see them?
Yes.
I don't remember seeing
anybody.
The
first one was chocolatey. And that's why we was like, oh, that's Issa. Then the next one was a little lighter skin. Like, they, I promise you, make a bet. How much you won't bet? I bet $1 billion. It was about 3 different women.
The reason I'm asking is because when Daniel was over at his sister's house.
And old girl, what's her name? Vanessa? She ain't tripping.
Well, I wish she's not like that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you're putting way too much on it, all right? That door closed.
Who closed it?
If your sister knows someone's name, then that's kind of significant.
Because
your siblings, they're not going to know every random person that you just
seen
up with. But if they have a name,
mm-hmm.
And when his sister was like, oh, who's going to babysit Jada, Issa, or Vanessa?
Mm-hmm.
It made it seem like it was like a love triangle type of thing. Like, he had, at least Vanessa, I don't know if that was his girlfriend, but it was a steady partner.
Vanessa has, very light skin. The first woman he was in the bed with was Godiva Dark Chocolate.
It was dark.
No, girl!
No. What the heck? We're all dark when the lights are out at night.
Child, please. That was about 15 different. He was sleeping with 25 different women in that scene.
I don't think Daniel was out there like that.
Okay. Maybe not 25, but it definitely was more than one.
Okay. Do you think Daniel was just in a rotation, or was it just one steady person?
I didn't really know like who's to really say.
Did y'all watch the show? Because I watched the show.
I guess I just saw different women.
I didn't see no women.
I believe that. I guess I just didn't pay attention to that part because I just like, okay, I know you're in there, you know.
You're in there.
Close your eyes.
No. Daniel does say something about, oh, Vanessa is wondering when you're gonna be gone, right? So right. He does bring up someone, but I promise you, it's more than one woman that he's having sex with that at the beginning of the show. Now, maybe it's not my fault that the lighting and the camera angles didn't catch her face, and it was only on legs and clavicles and waist. That's not my fault. Did you want it to be Issa?
Yes, I did.
At first, I did.
Now, see, both of y'all was up here. We love Lawrence. Oh my God,
we love Lawrence. But you know, I respected Lawrence of Lawrence saying like, you know what, this is what happened. You know, no. So you know, I respected him saying like, you know, no. So you know, if she gonna go back to Daniel, and you know, I'm like, you know what, maybe she can see what's going on over here. Will it last forever? I don't know. But I was like, you know what, if it's Daniel and Issa, you know, it's Daniel and Issa. You know. I didn't know when the scene was opening up. That was like, because that was like the thing, like, you know, watching it back, it was like, oh my God, like she's on the couch. He liking other girls. It was so awkward. It was weird. She's a Lyft driver. She's staying with him. It's just like, oh, I really don't want to be over here.
She a Lyft driver. Somebody throw up in her car. Yeah. She can't look in the mirror and do her little freestyles because he ain't got, why you ain't got no medicine cabinet mirror, bro?
Boys, you know.
You got a whole nice leather couch. Look like it come from West Elm. You got about 50,000 records in there. You can't install the medicine cabinet yourself.
They don't need it.
Issa's he as fine as he is. He like he just look into the wall and be like, I know I look good. But her current situation is tough right now. Like she's not happy at work. I think we see more. And I mean the racism that we saw in season one and season two at We Got Y'all. It was there, it was prevalent, but it felt there like it was something I was laughing at because it didn't feel heavy. It didn't feel dangerous to me. Now it feels like, man, like she's being like verbally abused at this place and taken advantage of when that white woman yells at her. Every time we have a problem here, you're at the, you know, it's because of you. You need to get to the bottom of that. It's like, Jesus Christ, like, I don't want to deal with this. Like it felt especially oppressive. So she's just not in a good space professionally, romantically, financially, socially. Ooh. I would say, or maybe socially she's okay because she still has her core group, but I mean her living situation is not pleasant at all.
No.
Can we talk about why she went to Daniel's house out of everybody's house she could have went to?
Well, I think she knew she couldn't go to Molly's house because she just can't stay with her as friends. That's going to be like clashy.
When they talking about, oh, you broke my vase. No, I didn't.
Oh,
that was weak.
Weak.
Yeah, that was weak. I think they just know the bigger picture is that, you know, it's like, we're going to be like, cool. Cool. And it's like,
appreciate, I don't know if y'all can hear it. I don't know if the microphone will pick it up, but Kalesha has on the nails right now.
Oh my God.
You know, ghetto length, and I support it. And so when she does she does that, you know, I just want you to know that I appreciate it.
Oh my God.
I don't buy that, honey. I don't buy nails. Even
Kelly even Tiffany.
Okay.
She couldn't Tiffany, stay with no
Tiffany. I can't stay with Tiffany. Her husband is cool. I think Tiffany would be like, well, can you make sure that you put your washcloth when you're done, like on the thing so I can wash it?
Yeah.
It's going to be that. Or she stay with Kelly. It's like, yeah, you could stay with Kelly, I guess. It's like, Kelly's not the first go-to. I think Molly's her most comforting. Like, I could be myself. Like, I can be all up through your house and you really not going to care. And Molly's cool with that. But I think, like, every day we're going to see each other, it is going to be like a little... So I think a part of her was like, okay, Daniel, I can feel comfortable with. Like, I can be comfortable with Daniel. And other part of her was also like, I could like him. I think she was thinking, like, I could feel comfortable with him. And, you know, maybe we could see what happens.
Well, he did call her out later in the episode.
Yeah, he did.
He was like, well, why are you? Because she made up some excuse like, oh, you're close to the work.
Right.
Well, why do you think she chose Daniel's spot?
I don't know. She wanted to
see.
Be maybe with him.
Yeah, I think she wanted to. I agree with you. I think she wanted to just, you know, sometimes you just feel like, you know, let me just see. I think she kind of felt like, okay, Lawrence is done. Like, he really does not like me. Like, it's done. And I really don't want to stay with my girlfriends right now. The only friend I want to stay with is Molly. And I just feel like she was thinking, like, let me just see what Daniel's talking about.
Yeah.
And I think, he is a genuinely nice guy.
I think Tiffany is too stuck up. Kelly is too crazy. I think she could have stayed. I think she doesn't want to stay with her brother because I think that would have been volatile. I think that she doesn't want to stay with Molly because she wants to stay with Daniel. And I feel like after coming off of that breakup that we were dealing with for all of season two, you just wanted to be in a space where the romance is ripe. I'm not obligated to take part in it, but I think it was less of, you know, we're friends and I really care about him. I think it's more of, I'm excited about the romantic tension that's going to be in this house when I'm living here.
Sure, that could really be it. That could really be something.
I think she thought she was going to play this game like, oh, Daniel, I'm just going to be on your couch, you know, just as friends, you know, I'm not trying to start nothing. Mm-hmm. And I think she probably thought he was going to make a move on her and she would have allowed it. But when he doesn't make a move on her, when he's like, oh, you want to be friends? Okay, we are strictly friends, roommates. That's it. Mm-hmm. And then he set the boundary. And I don't think she was expecting that boundary to be set by him. And so when he's with other girls, she's like, oh my gosh, like I didn't see this coming.
Yeah. And she's in a sticky spot because she doesn't make enough to really get an apartment as decent.
We're introduced to another love interest, the first episode in season 3.
Hey, Nathan with the face.
You about to come with your fine ass.
Yeah, he left Nathan a $50 tip. I was like, meow, you must really like me.
I mean, he did get in a fight.
But you left me $50 though? You are really trying to.
No, but he stood up for her because in this lift pool, the other guy, he was smoking.
Oh, yeah.
Doing too much.
Get another lift.
No, what I should do is reach up.
Nathan's little butt beat that big man up and bounced.
My eyes.
So he left a good first impression and with a tip.
Well, he was LA bashing. And I have to say that was getting on my nerves when he was. So when he got in the car, he looked a little sleepy, but he was very handsome. He is very handsome. And, you know, Issa's like, it's going to be 30 minutes to get to where you're going. 30 minutes for 4 miles, man. See, that's what I hate about LA. You know, that you LA true. Chicks is crazy. Y'all be wild. All right. You from Houston and you know, I just look, calm down, bro. Calm down. You living in LA and you're in a lift. I'm assuming you might be doing all right for yourself. Chill out. What you mad for? else 30 minutes. So what? You ain't driving? Sit back. Put your seatbelt on. Take one of these Capri Suns.
Capri Sun?
Capri Sun?
I think he was just saying what I think that's most people's criticism of LA. Yeah. I've never been, but I heard the traffic is crazy.
Yeah.
And getting around downtown is crazy.
So why you moved there?
Well, we didn't know he moved there. You're a mystery. We didn't know that. We just knew he was in the lift. We didn't know if he was visiting.
That's very true.
He was visiting.
That's very true.
And this was his first time. So you don't know he lived there.
But I do know he lived there because I watched the whole season.
Yes. But from this first episode, we don't know him.
We don't know him.
But I know you watched the whole season too. So now that you know him, answer that question. Why you moved there when you, if you got an issue?
What's you don't know why he couldn't move from work. He could have, did he ever?
You cut hair, baby. You cut hair. You cut hair.
It's still a job. It's a job.
But you didn't need to move for work.
It's a job.
True. It's just a job. And then also, like, you know, he's probably just saying it like, you know, a little conversation starter. Sometimes people do that.
That's very true.
Mm-hmm. You're like, dang, why y'all always drive like this out here? Because you need the girl to kind of be like, what you mean? Why are you talking about my city? It's a little vibe. Let me go ahead and get the conversation started, you know.
Well, one thing
he did what Issa tried to do, how he want to say something slick so they can reply.
Yep.
Something cute. But when Issa tried to slick Daniel into, oh, I'm going to sleep on your couch, ha, 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 it didn't work in her favor. So, you know, they play in the same game. They play the same game.
I like that. I like that. I think that the crazy lift ride that happens as a result of Nathan protecting Issa's vehicle and, you know, Chunky Thug smoking the marijuana and drinking up all the Capri Suns and calling them bitches. Like, come on now. I feel like all of that craziness happens to show Issa that, honey, you trying to avoid these feelings that you have for Daniel and the discomfort that you feel in his house. You going to work, but you're not going to find no comfort at work either. Because either somebody throwing up in your car or you have to have Molly ride along with you so you can be comfortable. No, girl, like, stop trying to leave the house. Quit running away from stuff. And we see her doing that even more when those two guys are fighting in the car, because when that guy's like, oh, I thought this was supposed to be a fun ride. Y'all bitches doing too much.
Y'all bitches said it's a party lift.
Wow. Tell him all.
You're expecting her to verbally reprimand him, even though you're the driver, even though this is your car. You should be doing that. When they start fighting, Molly's like, do something. What am I going to do? Pull over. I can't find a spot. Stop the car. I'm going to get a ticket. Girl, handle this. Like, you, Issa, like, never wants to handle anything. I think that we're still seeing, like, that was from season one when she had an issue with Lawrence. You didn't want to handle it. So you literally staying over at Molly's house night after night because you don't want to deal with the issues at home.
Can we talk about Dro now?
Oh, God. Vomit inducing Dro. Sure.
And this relationship. Well, this love triangle, really. Is it an open relationship or no?
I think it is. I think he's really on the phone. I think his wife really calls him.
She calls him.
And he's like, I'm with Molly, so we're not hiding anything. Huh?
Okay, but Molly is a friend. So,
but baby, you're not about to be with your friend early in the morning like that.
Okay,
And he said, I'm still at Molly's. Or did he say, I'm at Molly's? He probably didn't go home that night.
I don't think he went home.
Yeah.
But I'm still 50-50 on this whole open relationship thing.
Same.
Well, why do we never see Candace
and Molly at the same time?
And Molly at the same time discussing the relationship. Mm-hmm. Why do we never?
They don't discuss that.
Yeah, like, why do we
Sister wives don't do that. Sister wives don't talk amongst each other.
you know?
But I mean, we also never see Candace with any of her partners. I guess what I'm saying is we don't see...
But ain't she pregnant in this or no?
Oh, she is pregnant. But I mean, she can still have other partners. If this is a truly polyamorous situation, like, she doesn't have to be sleeping with them. And she, or she could if she wanted to. You can sleep with people when you're pregnant.
I'm thinking about having sex with another partner, another person while you're pregnant.
Pregnant is kind of weird.
There are people who get into relationships when they're pregnant.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true.
And
true.
So, I mean, it is, I'm sure.
Something that's not like, oh my God, yeah.
It happens.
But why do you think the show is not allowing for us to see anything going on with Candace?
Because I think it's a fake open relationship.
Oh, wow.
Let it be known, Dan.
But I see, if, I feel like if it was fake, they really would have showed that. They really would have showed Candace being like, what's going on? How, that would have made it a very interesting story. I feel like the writers wouldn't have passed up on that. Do you think it's a fake relationship because you just don't like Dro?
No, to me, I think, I don't understand why Molly agreed to this in the first place.
As it's someone who's Molly seen, acting like she can't get no dude, like Molly could get all the dudes, and you settling for Dro.
As someone who, in previous episodes and seasons, she wants a relationship. Yeah. She wants happily ever after. You know, she wants something serious. And you doing this with your friend, like, it's contradicting what she says she wants. So I don't understand why she agreed to this type of relationship. And even in it, she still, it's not what she wants, because she's like, oh, I can't do this. I need boundaries. Either we're friends or we're not friends. We can't be both. I can't, like, she doesn't can't do know it.
Yeah.
She can't handle it. So why are you setting yourself up for failure?
Well, you know the kid do not like Molly, but what I will say is at the top of season three, she is saying that she wants something different for herself and she wants to keep people in their place. So when we first see Molly at the top of the episode, she is on a beach and she is talking to this guy that she has been spending her vacation with.
I'll be in LA in a few weeks.
Oh, you got a visa?
From Cincinnati.
She doesn't know, and also I don't think she wants to know. And I think she has that conversation with Issa about, you know, I just want the dude in Chicago to be a sexual partner. I just want Dro to be a friend that I have sex with. She is saying that she wants to, like, have these sexual pairings. I mean, she might be, but also I'm glad that she has that conversation with Dro, you know, and she says, like, I need boundaries. You don't need to be making me pancakes. What are you doing?
He,
like,
had a key to her house.
He did have a key to her house. She asked for it.
Did he have it in the first place?
That's true.
That's not, you don't do that with side dudes. You don't give no side dude the key.
Come on, okay, man. Okay, so when they get into that fight, and she says that you can have me whenever you want.
Just because you and Candace get to do whatever and fuck whomever don't mean we all want our shit that messy.
Do you feel like she was wrong for saying that? Do you feel like Dro is disrespecting the boundaries that she puts in place? Or do you think that she is kind of giving off mixed signals?
Mixed signals.
Mm-hmm. Okay, why do you say that?
One, why does this man have a key to your apartment?
But she asked for it back.
But why did he have it in the first place?
Why he got it?
Why are you sleeping with this man?
Thank you.
Because she wants to sleep. Because they have an open... We don't know if it's fake.
Okay.
We don't know if the setup between Dro and Candace is fake. We know what Dro told us.
Okay.
And she's attracted to Dro. Okay. And she wants to have sex with Dro. So that's why they having sex. Because she want to. Not okay. A key. I can't explain that. I can't explain that.
I feel like as far as the boundaries, I don't think she knows. I don't think she knows what she's doing. Mm-hmm. Because if this is simply just a physical relationship, why don't spend the night, you leave. You get up. Like, she's... she's not even, I don't know what rules she's playing by, but ain't no spending the night, ain't no key, mm-hmm. ain't no, like, that should never happen in the first place. So I don't understand why she blew up on him at the end. It's like, girl, you messed this up.
I also feel like a part of me was feeling like she was projecting. Like when she said, like, oh, you and Candace can just do whatever y'all want. Y'all can be messy all that you want. It's kind of like, you know what? You just don't want to admit, Molly, you're being messy right now. Mm-hmm. You're being messy right now. You can have it whenever you want. You're going to get this man a key to your house. But then you just didn't know how to handle it. And I think also part of Molly, her makeup is that she is very competitive and she just wants to win.
And Molly can get a guy. Like, Molly's beautiful. Molly's smart. Molly got money. Molly can get a dude, you know?
But she can't keep him.
Dang.
And that's why I think she was just trying to hold on, because he was just so steady. He was more than just like, oh, I'm with you for a night. It was like, you know, like,
there was potential with him.
There was potential. She kind of maybe felt like, you know, maybe we never actualized our potential back in the day. Mm-hmm. Then like, oh, now you're married, and then dang, she's pregnant. And it's like, okay, but you open. So it's kind of like, I kind of just want you here. You know, so she kind of don't know what she's doing. She's one foot in, one foot out. And I kind of feel like, you know, you're saying like, oh, if y'all are so messy. It's like, no, Molly, you're very messy. But Molly has a problem with admitting stuff. And Molly's extremely like, I'm about to try to win this.
Well, when you say she's trying to win this, do you think, are you saying that she's trying to beat Candace? Or are you saying that she's trying to make it work? Like someone who's, you know, if someone says like, hey girl, I don't think you can handle that polyamorous stuff, girl. I think you should give it up. Nope, I'm going to win. I'm going to show you I know how to handle being in this love triangle thingy. You know, is it that she wants to win at playing the polyamory game, or she wants to sway Dro to being with her and her only?
A part of me kind of feels like it was a Dro thing, because I think that's more, and I know they didn't like go into deep, I mean, into like more depth about it in the season, but a part of me feels if it's like the Molly that's portrayed, I feel like Molly wants to take the whole thing, and when she gets the whole thing, she won't want it anymore.
That whole, I've known you since we were kids, we grew up next to each other.
Right.
It's a different type of bond. Even though he's married, we don't know how or when he met Candace, but we can assume that the bond he has with Molly is, I don't know if you can say it's deeper, but it's more rooted. There's a lot of roots there because they've grown up with each other. So it's like, it's not someone you just met in college or you just met them 3 years ago or something. They have a lot of personal ties together. So, and I think they do care for each other. They have a special place in each of their hearts. Mm-hmm. Probably just friendship. But
true.
I think Molly thinks, oh, this is someone who we've cared about each other for a very long time. Mm-hmm. Even though it's probably different for how he feels for his wife.
Yeah.
But I think Molly thinks that her relationship with him is deeper than he can have with anybody, even his wife.
True. I agree with you 100%, Nicole. Molly's quick to just like, I conquered this. I'm on to the next thing. It's like, you know, like she'll win this award. Like if I was given an analogy, she'll like win like all of the medals for track. Mm-hmm. And next year it's like, Molly, you need to run a track. Oh, I don't want to run a track. Like she's on to the next thing. That's kind of get that vibe from her.
I feel like we see that with Enterprise Dude. You know, when she... This Enterprise. Is in season one, where she's the guy who works at Enterprise and they really hit it off, but you know, he didn't go to college. And then he had that homosexual experience.
Oh, the boy
one
was
time.
Yeah.
And it's
like
you went looking for stuff to be wrong. You know what I'm saying? So it's like once you conquered that thing, like what the first time they meet in that club where Issa is rapping about the broken pussy. And she ridiculously says in front of this man, oh, she's talking about me. You didn't even have to say that. He didn't have to know that, you know? So he walks away, but then they meet up again. And then they establish this really cool thing. True. Like to the point where you want to see him again. Like I wanted this to be her Lawrence. I wanted that relationship to feel like home, you know, but you just kept finding stuff to be wrong with that. You just couldn't get over, Yep. You know, I feel like the same might be the case for a dude in Chicago. Like, you know, like that really could be something, but you let the situation with Dro take you away from that.
Take you away. So, but I think going back to Nicole's point, she kind of feels like, I don't know, it just kind of feels like that's a situation where they have like this special thing, but is it really, like you said, Nicole, like it's really likely just friendship. Yeah. And I think they're getting all these like vibes out, you know, but it's like, you already know it's not going anywhere because he still has his allegiance to his wife. He's just kind of experiencing this. And I think Molly is kind of like, I know you got this thing with your wife, but I mean, you know, like, yeah. It just seemed like that.
We have history. Like that. I think right. Dro would
be enough.
The perfect mate for Molly, just being because they grew up in the same neighborhood. They live next door to each other. They know each other's parents. They probably come from the same socioeconomic background. Mm-hmm. They, you know, everything is the same. That's her counterpart. But they not together. He with somebody else.
Y'all never made it pop.
I'm not drawn into their friendship, probably because it's season two is the first time I see Dro. You never mentioned Dro. I'm not connected to this friendship that she's talking about. And so that's what also makes the relationship feel a little bit superficial to me. I mean, I know more about Issa's blood neighbor, like the guy in the gang. Like, I know more about him and I care more about him than I do about Dro.
True.
To be honest, like,
true.
I care more about what's old girl name from We Got Y'all,
Frida.
The white girl. I care more about Frida.
True.
Than I care about Dro.
True. 100% on that. 100%.
Well, I care more about Chad. Chad.
Lawrence's friend, the light skinned dude.
Oh, Chad.
He got a wife too, but we ain't never seen his wife.
Chad is right on purpose.
So at the end of the episode, we see Issa and Daniel at home together on the couch. Now, in previous scenes, they're having this argument about why is Issa there? Are they playing games with each other? What's going on? Issa is right to tell him, hey, please don't sit here and act innocent. You are bringing all these girls home when you know that you and I mean something to each other. So why are you doing that? You know?
Right.
And even though this is his house, child, he said, right. All right, I'm going to give you a heads up. And in this instance, he leaves the house.
I saw yours tonight. See you later, roommate.
And I think Vanessa is at the door because they're going on a date, because it's not just a simple hookup. I think this is a relationship between him and this Vanessa girl.
Well, when they are on the couch together, do you guys feel any romantic or sexual tension, or does it feel like we are just friends?
There's like a vibration.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be respectful because genuinely to the core, I am a nice guy. My name is Daniel. I'm really nice. And, you know, I'm going to give you your time. Like, you know, you can have a house to yourself. Like, I'm going to go over here and do with Vanessa or whatever. But I also feel like it's like they could take it however they're gonna take it, but he already knows, like, dang, I already done been with other women with her in the house. And then she's probably thinking, like, he don't even want me if he with other women in the house. So it's like, you know, I kind of feel like they're kind of like it's just laying dormant right now. But is there like a respectful, cute little vibration they got? Yeah,
it feels like Daniel is in a relationship and he doesn't want to cheat on his partner with Issa. Even though he does kiss Issa, and Issa's like, what are you doing? And he's like, what do you want? Either you want me to kiss you or you don't.
Right.
If you don't, then who I'm sleeping with should be none of your concern.
Right. And that's how boys be thinking. They be like, it's either red or blue. It's hot or cold.
I didn't feel any romantic tension. I didn't feel any sexual tension, but I certainly felt an awkwardness. That was on that chair between
them. You know what this was like?
What?
Remember in Sylvie's Love when Sylvie was mad at when Robert kissed her and then he was like, and then she got mad at him when it was at the party. And he was like, what do you expect from me?
Thank you.
When a guy kisses a girl, I mean, she wants to think that she's some kind of special.
Exactly. It's the same thing. And then she was mad from the party and stuff like that. Oh my God, yeah. I love it.
And then she does go into his space, even though she doesn't know that he's going to be at the party. But also, don't you know that he's going to be at that party? I'm going to the party of his bandmate. Like, you know he was going to be there.
And Issa,
you are going into Daniel's space. Like, you're putting yourself in this, in these awkward moments here. When they're on that couch together, I don't feel a sexual tension. I don't feel a romantic tension. I do feel an awkward tension. There's an awkward air going around. And it's not until she gets up and leaves because she's about to go drive for Lyft. And I said, now you got the house all to yourself. I would think you would want to take advantage of that and just be in that space alone. But this is like the opening of the episode when she's hearing him having sex with someone in his bedroom. And she leaves to drive for Lyft so that she can avoid hearing them have sex. So now you're leaving even though the house is empty. It's, to me, it feels like what she wants is to be in the house alone with him.
Hey, y'all. Hope you enjoyed the show. Hit us up on Instagram at Curry Gumbo. Hope to see you next week. Bye.
See you guys soon.
Later, alligator.